Well, I was impressed with those target receptions. That was very good. I first saw this film about Ingo just a few months ago. I was very touched. There was Ingo just standing there like I knew him, talking. And film is so wonderful because Ingo is still with us, thanks to Mary Ann Billen. I first met Ingo when he came to an open house at the American Society for Psychical Research, the ASPR, where I worked in research. I found him to be extremely kind, an intelligent and interesting gentleman. So who would want to work with him? We agreed that we were creative, invisible beings operating through bodies. He called it an operating thing. I called it a spiritual being. But we knew we were on the same page and were eager to get more information on this all-important reality. We began with perceptual tests on what I called out-of-body vision and he called exterior vision. But we didn't let terminology interfere with discovery. Our mutual purpose was to find out how this works and share that information with others so they might act on it. Ingo was sensitive in the purest sense of the word, and he cared so much about our work together. We were co-experimenters as he went inside the earth on what I call the Great American Oil Hunt, out into space to Mercury and Mars, and later he went with others all around the globe. And he and I used to walk a lot because New York is such a special place to walk. Anyway, back at the ASPR, we wanted to know how he was able to see things which were outside his visual range. Someone else placed targets out of view, and as he tried to identify these, I recorded the brain waves and other physical measurements. Our equipment was primitive compared to what you have today, but it appeared the pattern during remote viewing was theta waves with beta riding on top, the brain waves. This would be a low voltage mixed pattern. Ingo's impression of that was this pattern is associated with awareness and scanning the whole scene while exterior, theta, and beta for decision making and target perception. There was usually a cessation of eye movements as he felt they distract the exterior vision in some way. He even wore a blindfold sometimes to keep his eyes from moving. I explain all this work in my book, Out of Body Handbook. Now, Dr. Persinger can tell you much more about Ingo the Brain today with his advanced studies, as you will see in the film. In 1973, Ingo and I went to many oil field locations from Tennessee to Texas. His drawings of the underground structures, in some cases, were correct to what was known by geophysics and seismography. I was surprised to learn at that time that seismography was not so effective in those days. That's why you had all those people out there with their divining rods and looking for oil and water, and wildcatters who would try anything they could think of to discover oil. So this deep remote viewing where he looked for depth and volume, this was a very practical use of the ability in the day. I don't know how good the detection of the oil resources are now, but this could be a very practical use. Ingo said that in order to have this extended perception, we must allow subjective data to be included in our analysis. Women know all too well about intuition. He said men, in their present condition, this was in the 70s, rely solely on objective data, and in order to know that which is beyond ordinary perception, we must be open and accepting of subjective data. From my brain physiology studies, we know that a woman can transfer this information more easily than a man because of the connection between the right and left hemisphere. So Ingo added that as we do this and get hits, our confidence will increase and we will naturally get better at it. And if we get misses, we will also be able to pick up the characteristics of the misinformation coming from the subjective side. Also, about this time, I recorded notarized reports of what Ingo and Harold Sherman were able to perceive around Mercury and Mars. These reports were sent to several research laboratories. Before the spacecraft reached the planets and began relaying back their information. Some of these perceptions were confirmed, especially Ingo saw the atmosphere on Mercury when they didn't know there was one, and he even drew the shape of the atmosphere, which was more tawny, and that was due to the solar winds that so the atmosphere wasn't straight around the planet but off that way. So that was pretty impressive finding in 1973, I can tell you. Now Dr. Silfen came in from Seton Hall. She was a perceptual psychologist out there. She brought in flicker fusion equipment and other perceptual kinds of brightness comparator and a black box, which she created herself. And we worked with these devices, and Ingo seemed to learn a lot about light on this exterior vision. And so this was very helpful to him. And off in another room, he could often tell you the brightness comparative results, you know, 50% of the time with his exterior vision. So that was very good, I thought. In the years that we worked together, Ingo felt that we learned a lot and his exterior vision improved. I was honored to have had the opportunity to work with the best psychic I ever met. We know that some part of us is able to transcend time and space because we have all these results. I believe that we are getting closer to knowing the truth of who we are and how we operate. In order to make our leap in consciousness, which we all desire to heal the planet, we need to know the process and qualities of our innate extrasensory qualities, abilities. We know they produce kinetic effects, alter molecular activity, and light, so there must be some invisible, yet physical, aspect to these abilities. I loved what President Václav Havel of Czechoslovakia said to our Congress. Without a global revolution in the sphere of human consciousness, a more humane society will not emerge. That was 1990, 27 years ago, so how are we doing? It seems to me we're living under a mistaken identity, which profits the powers to be and keeps us separated so that we're more easy to control. Most social problems come from an identity as bodies. We keep coping with the problems such as racism, sexism, now or even what country your body was born in. But these could all be transcended if we could just identify ourselves correctly as creative, invisible beings who own and operate bodies. When we speak about body, we use ownership terms, my hand, my head. Our bodies are not to limit us, but to give us a visible means of interaction on this plane of activity. I wrote this in 1980. If we fail to realize or experience that we are traveling in space at this very moment through the Milky Way galaxy at 43,000 miles an hour and around the sun at a speed of 66,600 miles per hour, on a planet wobbling and rotating on its axis one revolution per day, and yet we can stand right out on top of the Earth with nothing holding us down but an invisible force of gravity. Is it not possible that there are other profound yet subtle phenomena that occur without our conscious knowledge? So now it's up to you to recognize and understand how our extrasensory abilities work. It's a tough job, but somebody's got to do it. Find out who you are, how you operate, what you came to this planet to do, and get it done.